George Blaha, and this is the From Glory Days show, which chronicles the lives of professional Detroit athletes following their pro sports careers. Watch the stories unfold as former Detroit Pistons, Tigers, Red Wings, and Lions share their personal stories of struggle and success as they have transitioned from the pinnacle of their pro sports careers back into normal everyday lives. You won't find another show like the From Glory Days show capturing this transition as told directly by the athletes themselves.
Hi, I'm Jeff Ivory, the financial pro featured on the PBS series From Glory Days. Keep an eye out for my financial tip during today's show, and feel free to visit my website for more information and tips on staying financially fit.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help? Hello, I'm Kurt David, author of the best-selling book, From Glory Days, and your host of the show. Today's guest played his high school, collegiate, and professional basketball right here in Detroit. His pro career spanned over the course of 19 years and includes an NBA championship with the Detroit Pistons of 1989. Let's give a nice warm welcome to our guest, John Long. John, great having you on the show. I mean, there's so many things with your career. I mean, the spanning over 19 years is phenomenal, for one. But just, you know, from high school to college to you know, that long, lengthy time that you had playing professionally, what are some of the best memories that you have?
Well, my fondest memories, I mean, I have quite a few, but my college days was unbelievable with my teammates and Vitale coming on the scene.
University of Detroit, right. Dick Vitale.
And he really actually got the program back on the map. And my junior year, we were like 21-0 going into a game against Marquette University. And that's when they had Al McGuire as the coach. And so Vitale, being a New Jersey guy, and McGuire and all those guys, they were friends forever. So we going against him. We end up pulling off that game, winning by 2 points at the buzzer by Dennis Boyd hitting the jumper. So we went to 22-0. Then we go to Duquesne University, play against Norm Nixon, and they beat us in double overtime and broke our winning streak. So during that time, college, that was probably the best time of my life because we had a nice winning streak. We were known all over the country, you know, as a very good college team. And we lost to the University of Michigan in the NCAA tournaments. And then they lost to Cedric Maxwell, who played with Cornbread Maxwell, who played with the Boston Celtics. They lost, Michigan lost to them. And Marquette ended up winning the championship that year. So, I mean, if we would have got past Michigan, we had an opportunity to play against Marquette again for the national championship. So that was one of my greatest moments remembering that time in college, because that's the best time of your life. Mm-hmm. You know, you're coming out of high school, you're going to the next level, you meet new friends again. It's a different challenge, and you're playing with different people. And we ended up bonding so well together. You know, that's your second family. You have your first family with your immediate family, but your teammates, you together so much, you sweat so much together, you do so many things together.
In the trenches together.
Yeah, that's your second family.
Absolutely.
So.
You know, you had a great high school career, obviously, and you know, we know that you had the pro career, and we'll talk about that in a moment, but the college career are some of your best memories because of that, for the success that you had at UAD. Obviously, you had some great talent around you as well.
Yeah, there's no question about it. I mean, my teammates, when you talk about Dennis Boyd, was probably one of the best guards in the country, and we had Walter Smith, Ron Bostic. We had Kurt Thomas, who played with us, and Terry Tyler, who was a teammate of mine in the
names.
Pros.
Yeah, some great.
Terry Durod played with the Boston Celtics and played with Larry Bird. So we had quite a few guys. Earl Cureton, he was redshirted the 1 year, so he didn't get opportunity to really play with us when we had our tournament run. But we had some pretty good talent on that team.
At what point did you realize that professional sports was going to become a reality for you?
Working hard as I did, and the recognition that we got. You know, Dick Vitale said to us it was a possibility that we might get drafted. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because my junior year, he stepped down from being the coach because he had bleeding ulcers and stuff, so he couldn't coach our senior year. So he ended up taking off a year, and after my senior year, he ended up getting hired by the Detroit Pistons as the head coach. And so by him getting drafted, getting the head coaching job, he drafted Terry Tyler and myself. Mm-hmm. So we ended up getting drafted by the Detroit Pistons and end up staying home. We were two local guys. And Dick said, hey, I want everybody to know that I'm not just drafting these guys because they played for me in college. These guys can flat out play. So he was giving us the opportunity. He said, look, it's a lot of pressure on me for you guys to deliver. I got all the confidence in the world in you guys. I want you to just come out and be yourself and play. End up being for 15 years.
And you know, through that time, you have lots of great memories of professional sports. And, you know, I wish we had time to talk about every minute of it. Unfortunately, we don't. But what were some of the good memories? I mean, you spent a lot of time here in Detroit with the Pistons and obviously a championship. What does that mean to you?
First 8 years I spent here with the Detroit Pistons. Oh, the championship was the highlight. I mean, that's what you play for. When you win a championship, you have bragging rights. And so, you know, everybody loves a winner, a champion. And, you know, that opened up a lot of doors for a lot of players on the team, you know, winning the championship. But, you know, you can play for all the money in the world, but if you don't have that championship ring, you don't have anything to brag about.
So that meant a lot
winning,
to you.
Well, winning that was the ultimate goal. Yeah. I mean, you know, that's what it was all about. We had an outstanding year. The guys that I played with on the team were great. You know, we were great teammates, and we really cared for one another. We pulled together at the right time, and we meshed together at the right time, and we went very far. I mean, had an unbelievable season. We're playing with Isaiah and Joe and Vinny and Rodman and Sally and Lambeer and Rick Mahorn, all those
Some
guys.
Great I names.
Mean, oh, man.
Detroit, great Detroit names, obviously. And so over that time, I mean, that wasn't where it ended for John Long. I mean, John's career, your career continued much longer after that. And in fact, you know, phenomenally longer. Are you 40, 41 years old before you were done playing?
I went from the Pistons getting traded from Detroit. They end up sending me to Seattle. But Lenny Wilkins called me on the phone and said, hey, this is not going to happen. The Pacers want you really bad. Mm-hmm. Jack Ramsey, they want you really bad in Indiana. Detroit don't know this is going on, but we're going to trade you to Indiana. So I end up going to Indiana playing with Clark Kellogg, Herb Williams, Wayman Tisdale.
Reggie.
Reggie came in my second year. So I end up mentoring him. So, you know, mentoring him and to have an opportunity to play with Joe. So you're talking about two Hall of Famer guys that, you know, I was in the same company with. So, you know, seeing those guys grow and seeing the success that they had, you know, that made me feel really good because, you know, I had something to
You were a big part
something.
Of that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And so it wasn't just playing at that time. I mean, you still continue to have success as a team and as an individual, like you said, either personally or helping other players become great players, I mean, over that time. And as time went on, there was a point when you realized that, boy, you know, this isn't going to last forever. And at what point did you start realizing that you know, things were going to change for you as far as pro sports?
Well, when you play for 15 years, And you're not playing the minutes that you were accustomed to playing when you first came in the league, you know, at some point in time, you started to feel like, you know, even though you're not getting the minutes, you know, how much longer do you want to do this? I was blessed. You know, the transition came easy to me because right when I retired, I got a call from Magic Johnson saying, hey, I'm putting a touring team together, and I want you to be a part of it. And so we end up touring from 1992 to 96 all over
Europe.
You
were still playing.
Yeah, so I was still competing, playing against the best players over in Europe. I had opportunity to continue to play and something that I loved doing for obviously a long time. But that was my way of staying in shape and staying in contact with the game. But, you know, I went on tour. The first time we went on tour, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar went with us 1 year. Bob McAdoo went with us 1 year. And then we ended up having guys like Lester Conner, who's the assistant coach for the Atlanta Hawks now. You had Earl Cureton went on tour with us. I had Kurt Rambis.
It was like a rock tour.
Who was the head coach with the Minnesota Timberwolves. So, you know, Mark Aguirre went with us. So we had an NBA team that we went over there and played against all the national teams.
So basically, you were still, you know, playing very competitively with some great players around you. At what point did you start realizing that, boy, this is, I mean, that went on for some time. Then what happened after that?
Well, after that, after 4 years of touring with the national teams, I come home. I'm getting ready to go over to Africa with Magic to meet Nelson Mandela. I get a phone call from Isaiah Thomas, who's the general manager and a teammate of mine for 8-9 years, he's the general manager with the Toronto Raptors. He said, look, John, I know you're getting ready to go on Magic tour again, and I want you to come back and play. I want to sign you to come back and play. I want you to be a mentor to Tracy McGrady, straight out of high school. So I'm like, well, this is really nothing to think about. You want me to come back at a time like this? Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So I called Magic. He said, look, I already know I spoke to Isaiah, and he told me you was going to do this, and I'm happy for you. Go back and play. He said, not too many people can come back and play.
Have an opportunity like that.
So go back and play. So I came back and played for 2 years. I mentored Tracy McGrady. He ended up having a great career in the league. And in 98, I come back to Detroit, and I'm thinking about, well, what am I getting ready to do? Mm-hmm. Well, Matt Dobick, who was the PR guy for the Pistons, said, look, John, we got a vacancy with the radio job. Are you interested in doing radio? Because they had offered me a job as a head coach in the development league. Mm-hmm. And so I looked at that, and it's like, okay, for 3 months I would have been with this team, and then I would have been back without a job. Mm-hmm. So I was like, look, this makes a lot of sense, man. I think what I'll do is I'll take your offer, and I'll do the radio. Mm-hmm. So from 98, 99, I started doing the radio for the Pistons. I did that all the way up until 2005, 2006.
You think that helped your transition as a player, that you stayed involved?
There's no question. I mean, being in contact with all the people that you were around your whole career and having that window open up where you had opportunity to take advantage of it, that's what I did. So it made my transition really easy, because after leaving Toronto in 98, I'm like making up my mind on what I'm going to do. Mm-hmm. Come back home, come to one of the Pistons games, and I'm sitting down, and I'm talking to Matt Dobick, and, you know, we're laughing about this and laughing about that. After halftime, he came back and said, look, we got an opportunity for you to do the radio here. Do you want to do it? And I said, yes. And I've been doing that, you know, all that time.
Yeah,
it really did.
You know, one of the things that I know about professional athletes is even though you have the emotional part that can help as far as being involved like that, you know, athletes take a 90% pay cut when they're done playing. I mean, that's a major lifestyle change. A lot of these guys struggle. What were some of the challenges for you after pro sports when you came out?
Well, I went after 98, and it's funny because right the second year of training camp, I broke my jaw. So I had a plate, had my mouth wired shut. So I couldn't play the second year I was in Toronto. Mm-hmm. So I knew, you know, there was time to do something else. So at that time, they put me in community relations there, and I was going around all the school with the players, making visits and mm-hmm. speaking at different schools and doing autograph sessions and stuff with the players. So that kind of like, you know, opened up the door for me, but I knew that this was something that, you know.
It was a reality at that point, that it started becoming that I'm not going to play anymore, and some of the challenges that came as a result after that then. So
all the opportunities came, and, mm-hmm. you know, what I did, I took advantage of them. And that's what you're supposed to do, and that's anybody who's been playing professional basketball, you've been making a lot of money, and then you go from making a lot of money to making an average salary.
Yeah.
You know, that's
a
wake-up call. But it's something that you get used to for the simple fact that you're still doing something that you love, and you still have an opportunity to make some money. Some money is better than no money.
Well, that's absolutely true. Well, we're going to take a break here for our educational minute, but when we come back, more about John Long after basketball.
You know why we struggle investing money? Our brain plays tricks on us. We've all heard buy low and sell high, yet our brain tricks us into just the opposite. Let me give you an example. In 1999, when the technology boom was at its height, investors should have been selling stocks and buying cheap bonds. Then in 2002, when the stock market had dropped, investors should have considered buying those stocks back and selling their bonds. But what really happened? Investors sold billions of dollars of their bonds in 1999 to buy those expensive stocks, and then sold those same stocks at a loss in 2002 and put that money into cash. They bought high and sold low because it felt better. How do you avoid this monumental investment mistake? My tip for you is simple. Write out an investment policy statement, a set of rules and strategies to follow when managing the investments. It should help you avoid the pitfalls of losing money by buying high and selling low. For more tips on handling life's financial challenges, please visit jwifinancial.com.
I'm Kurt David, back with our guest, John Long. John, when we left, we talked about that life after pro sports, and at that time you started to know that there was going to be a transition. You got into some radio, doing different things as well. Help me understand what that was like for you. Coming out of pro sports, I mean, the long time that you had to play was phenomenal, for one. 40, 41 years old. What were some of the challenges for you at that time as a result?
Well, the challenges was getting adjusted to not traveling anymore as much as I was. And I had a lot of time to be around family and spend a lot of time with my family, where you're always on the road all the time. You don't get that opportunity. And then I think what really helped me is making my contacts and stuff early. And I would, you know, really suggest that to a lot of people. You know, when you're playing sports, you come in contact with a lot of people.
Quite a network, isn't
it? Yeah, and it really
network.
Is. And, yeah. And you can really help yourself a lot if you keep in contact with a lot of those people that you come in contact with, you know, because they're in different fields in life that, you know, you're going to have different opportunities that they might be able to help you. Mm-hmm. And I've been blessed as far as that. So it's been a struggle a little bit, not able to compete and stuff like that anymore. But, you know, you get over it because I had opportunity to travel still with Magic and play for those 4 years and then come back and play. So, you know, the adjustment for me was quite easy, you know, because I didn't have all that time to really think about it and say, well, what am I going to do now? Mm-hmm. You know, as I got finished with the tour, Isaiah called, wanted me to come back and play. So I spent 2 more years to come back and play. And then right after that, I come back to Detroit. I'm at a Piston game, and I'm sitting down talking to Matt Dobick, and we're talking about, you know, my next step on what do I want to do next. And that window of opportunity was right there where, hey, the radio was right there for me to
so
do.
So that helped your transition as far as, you know, one thing right to the next, and you didn't have that downtime or anything like that. What do you miss the most?
Well, you miss being in a locker room and guys, you know, you play sports. The guys talk a lot of trash, and that's your second family. So you have a lot of memories, always something going on in the locker room, and the locker room talking, and just being together and all that. I mean, you really miss that because you build a bond with all these different individuals on the team, and it's very special. And you miss that. So, you know, when you miss those type of things, you know, you have fond memories of the career and stuff that you had, and a lot of times you reminisce about the college days and all that when you're with your professional guys and stuff. So, you know, that kind of stuff you miss, but you get over it because the thing is, by me being surrounded by sports still and being a part of the organization, I really didn't get opportunity to really miss it like most guys because I stayed in contact with a lot of guys that I played against. And Bob Lanier was like my biggest mentor. When I first came to the Pistons, he helped me so much, it was unbelievable. And, you know, he always told me, he said, like, John, I want you to remember one thing. Whatever happened in this sport, don't never take it personal. It's a business.
It's a business.
It's a business first. I always remember that. And I always kept that in mind when I had some ups and downs in my career. And I always thought about what he said. Don't never take anything personal.
Have you found anything to replace that passion?
I come in contact with a lot of high school guys, college guys, and I'm like their mentor. You know, I give them advice. They help me stay in shape. So it's a two-way street. I done seen a lot of guys go overseas and have careers overseas playing basketball because they had opportunity to do some things with me, and the window of opportunity opened up for them to go over and play, and they were prepared for it. So I feel good about
helping,
you know,
others.
Being able to help somebody because somebody always helped me. And then it helps when you come from a big family. You know, I come from a big family, 6 boys and 4 girls,
well,
10 of my family. So. Well, I had a lot of mentors. You know, I was the baby in the family, so I had a lot of mentors that I really looked up to, my older brothers and my sisters. So, you know, that helped me mature a lot faster, and I always stayed grounded. No matter what I did, I never forgot where I came from, and I always, you know, knew that my family was going to be supportive and be there for me. So, you know, when you can keep all of that stuff together, it really makes it much easier for you to make transitions.
You had it to fall back on
as
a result.
Yes, absolutely.
And, you know, talking about family, certainly, you know, cousins, uncles, everybody was involved in different capacities with sports and different things and some great names, obviously, that come through your family as far as some of the relatives. And how did that help you think, not just during sports, but after sports as well? I mean, you guys swap stories, war stories, so to speak? Or
when I came up, you know, Terry Mills and Grant Long, you know, my sister and brother's kids, you know, they were always coming to my camps and always around me, so they wanted to be like their uncle. And so, you know, that was great for me to be a mentor to them, you know, as well as an uncle, you know, to somebody that they could look up to and say, hey, you know, if I work hard and I put in the work, I might have opportunity to go to college and make a career out of it. And they did pretty good themselves.
Absolutely.
But, you know, the times that you have as far as family-oriented picnics and barbecues and stuff like that, it's nothing like it because our family is so huge that, I mean, I got nephews and my older brothers and all them could play, and then the girls in the family could play. So we were real competitive, whether it was volleyball, baseball, whatever it was. Forget about basketball. It was competitive in everything.
So life and everything.
We had a lot of people in my family that just talked a lot. But, you know, that's the moment where you're having great times with family and stuff. But all your family had talent. And then you seen them progress and you seen them succeed in a lot of things. So it was very good.
They're happy for them, obviously, yeah, to see that. What kind of things are you doing now?
Well, I'm still working with the organization, still working with the Pistons. You know, I do a lot of stuff with the coaches and stuff now that, you know, you have the lockout. But, you know, one of the things that I was doing the most is doing appearances with the players. And we go around the schools and speak to the kids. Mm-hmm. You have autograph sessions. I done did stuff with the Red Cross, breast awareness, you know, for cancer and mm-hmm. stuff. So you speak about a lot of things. Just being in the community and being out in the community and being able to help people, you know, stay positive, you know, that's a reward that I like to think that I feel good about and able to help someone that, you know, need a little, you know, conversation sometime to maybe help, you know, them get over the edge, you know, because a lot of people in life, you know, basketball players have it easy. A lot of people in life have a difficult times, you know, with life. So to have somebody to communicate with and have somebody that believe in you and take a few minutes to talk to you, you know, that means a lot for the average person that don't get opportunity to speak to professional athletes.
Yeah, and giving back, that's so important to you. And we're going to take some time. It's one of my favorite parts of the show. We're going to give back right now because we're going to have some live studio audience question and answer.
All right.
Hi, I'm Ruth from Jackson, Michigan, and I understand you're the father of three daughters. What would you advise young women who are pursuing athletic careers today?
Well, you know, I had that with my first daughter, Brittany, and she played basketball for 2 years. And she came to me one day and called me honey at home. And she said, honey, I don't want to play basketball anymore. And I said to her, I'm like, look, you're not a boy. If you don't want to play basketball anymore, there's no pressure on you to play basketball, okay? You do what you want to do. Honor student, end up going to the University of Michigan. I graduated from the University of Michigan, and I have 2 in college now, so I was very proud of her. I have 2 grandsons, and, you know, I just tried to let them be themselves and say, hey, this is your life. You got to live your life, but long as you're doing it the right way, if you want to play sports, you play sports. But all of them were real good in books, so, you know, I let them determine their own destination as far as what they wanted to do.
Hi, my name's Jay. I'm from Rochester Hills. John, after a long 19-year career, what types of physical effects linger, if any?
Well, not a whole lot, but, you know, I have my moments as far as when it get a little cold, sometimes your knee have a tendency to hurt a little bit more than others. But other than that, I've been pretty blessed because I always took care of myself. And when you take care of yourself, you have a tendency not to have as many nagging injuries as you would if you just let yourself go and not do anything at all. So
this show is about the transition of professional athletes, but we want it to be more than that. In other words, what advice would you have for anybody, not just a pro athlete, what advice would you have for anybody that is facing change or adversity or some type of transition?
Well, when you've been a professional athlete and you've been an athlete all your life and it comes time for that transition, at some point in time, you know it's going to come. Mm-hmm. I would recommend that you make your contacts early in your career while you're still playing, doing different things during the summer that you can get involved in that you might think you want to do after your career is over with. If you do those things while you're still playing professional sports and your name is still out there and everybody knows your name, it's going to open up a lot of doors much easier than it would if you waited till that transition is over with.
So I
would, yeah, so I would recommend, you know,
using that,
see what your sources is early, yeah, and your contacts that you have, you know, take advantage of them. You know, you never know who you're going to meet. And athletes have a tendency to come in contact with some people that can be very powerful in different mm-hmm. positions. And you get opportunity when you win a championship, you go to the White House, you meet the president, you know. You get opportunity to meet a lot of people. So when you have those opportunities to meet people, treat people the way you want to be treated, first of all. But make your contacts And it makes your transition much easier when you have those contacts and you work on them early.
Well, I'm Kurt David, and this wraps up another show. I'd like to thank our guest, John Long, for joining us. Please join us next time when we watch the stories of professional athletes unfold from Glory Days.
Hi again. I'm Jeff Ivory, and I hope you enjoyed today's show and the educational minute I shared with you. If you'd like more information on staying financially fit through your life's transitions,
please visit my website at jwifinancial.com.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help?